Normally, 10 days after a mass shooting in America, we'd be on to the next story. We, meaning the national news media, we'd be moving on. Some reporters would remain on scene, trying to find out what the motive was, trying to find out about the survivors, but most reporters would be home by now, or maybe they'd be off covering the next shooting. Clearly, this time is different. The school shooting in Parkland, Florida is still very much in the news. And that's in large part thanks to the work of the students from the high school who are becoming activists now, who are planning a march that's less than a month from today that's expected to draw thousands. Now, we've seen several of these student activists, these leaders, take to the airwaves, not just right after the shooting, but again this weekend, trying to keep their cause on the forefront of everyone's minds. There are other reasons why the shooting still remains in the news as well. One of them are the excuses, these ridiculous excuses we're hearing from the police about their failures to enter the school more quickly and try to save lives. There's also a third reason why it remains in the news. Those conspiracy theories you've heard about, these sick smears that have been published on the web against some of the student survivors. These conspiracy theories are a form of pollution. Just like fake news, these kinds of ideas, they poison the media environment and they make all of us sick. It's a challenge for technology companies, a challenge for newsrooms, a challenge for politicians and for all of us as ordinary users of the web to try to come to grips with all of these theories, these lies, these hoaxes that spread virally after a tragedy. So let's start there with David Hogg. He's a senior from Marjorie Stoneman Douglas High School who survived the shooting, who was able to capture video during and after, and he's now been a subject of these attacks. And Dan Rather is also back with us here at the table. David, I have a lot I wanted to ask you, but I have to start with these terrible YouTube, Twitter, you know, good theories. If you search your name on Twitter right now, these lies about you being an actor are still at the top. How are you feeling about that?
It's great. It's great advertising, honestly. These people are doing an amazing thing in the sense that they're showing how disgusting they are. The fact that they're calling out me as a witness of this horrifying incident, saying that I'm an actor, a crisis actor, it shows how sad I feel for those people, honestly. Huh. Because they've lost faith in America, and we certainly haven't, but that's okay, because we're going to outlive them.
Going to outlive them.
Absolutely.
Do you think Google and Facebook and Twitter should do more, though, to try to tamp down this pollution?
I mean, honestly, these people that have been attacking me on the media, not the media, these people that have been attacking me on the social media,
yeah,
they've been great advertisers. Ever since they started attacking me, my Twitter following is now over 250,000 people. People have continued to cover us in the media. They've done a great job of that, and for that, I honestly thank them.
I'm impressed by that reaction. I didn't know how you'd react, given that it's been a week now of these lies on the web.
They're just proving what everyone else is saying, that they're disgusting individuals that have lost faith in America.
What about keeping this movement in the spotlight? You know, it's been 10, 11 days now since the shooting. I know you all are planning the march for March 24th. How are you all thinking about trying to keep your movement in the headlines?
I mean, honestly, those trolls online are doing a great job of it. We're really trying to stay in the headlines by reacting to what the NRA is saying, trying to point out that what Dana's trying to do, I believe she's the CEO of the NRA, she's trying to distract people. If you listen to her talk,
she's a national spokeswoman for the NRA.
Exactly. She's a national spokeswoman, and as such, she's a national propagandist for the NRA. If you listen to her speak, she's not really saying anything. She's sounding positive and confident, and that's what she wants the people in the NRA to believe, her 5 million plus members. She wants them to think that she's on their side, but she's not. She's actually working with the gun manufacturers because...
So you're trying to drive a wedge between the NRA leadership and its members.
Oh, I don't have to. She's doing that herself, honestly, because she's showing that she doesn't care about them. She doesn't care about police. Why do you think she's criticizing these people? It's because she's going after them, and she wants her base to continue attacking them so she can sell more guns.
Some of the criticism of the NRA and of Dana, very personally, are you concerned that you might actually lose support if you get too personal, too incendiary?
Well, she's already done that by attacking Sheriff Scott Israel, who... Obviously, there were some major mistakes made here and ones that we have to look into. And I don't want to say anything until after the investigation's done because I don't know what happened. Mm-hmm. I'm just a student that had to witness this horrifying incident. But honestly, how can you say that you support law enforcement if you're just constantly attacking them over this? How hypocritical and disgusting are you? These are the people that are trying to protect our lives. Did they make a mistake? Absolutely. Is that something that we have to fix? Absolutely. But there's a much bigger problem in Washington where they say that here's what Dana's been saying as a spokesperson for the NRA. She says that she wants to continue to pass laws She wants people in Congress to pass laws that help out with mental health and things like that, and she says that she can't do that. Are you kidding me? You own these politicians. You've passed legislation that enables these bump stocks, which, by the way, aren't allowed at NRA shooting ranges because they're too dangerous. That's how bad they are. But continuing on with my point, she wants Congress to take action and says that they won't. Are you kidding me? She owns these congressmen. She can get them to do things. It's just she doesn't care about these children's lives.
And where does the information come from when you talk about this?
My previous research in speech and debate, through learning about universal background checks, having to argue on both sides. I agree that the Second Amendment is important, but I think we should have limitations on it in the same way that we have limitations on the First Amendment. For example, I'm still allowed to speak here today. I'm allowed to speak to the press, but I can't yell fire in a crowded theater in the same way that you shouldn't be able to get an AR-15 if you're a mentally unstable 19-year-old. Hmm.
Dan, I wanted to have you here as well because you've covered movements for decades, social movements for decades, and I wonder what you make of this current student movement that we've seen emerge in the past week and a half.
I'm in awe and great admiration. This is a children's movement. Granted, it's somewhat, 16 to 19. We're being led by our children. It's reminiscent somewhat of the so-called Children's Crusade in Birmingham, Alabama, 1963, which was a bit of a tipping point for the civil rights movement when the students, when young people from Birmingham and surrounding areas came with Children's Crusade. Well, I'm calling this a Children's Crusade. This march could be a tipping point. This is the first time in years that I have sensed within myself we're near a tipping point. We'll see how big the march is. And the big thing is, do you and the other students have staying power? You have the willpower, but do you have the staying power? Because those forces who oppose what you're speaking of, they're depending on you wearing out, getting distracted, moving on to other things. That's their bet.
And I mean, that's kind of what the Florida legislatures were doing. They're trying to make us forget. There's a reason why only one Republican lawmaker at this Florida State House met with us. It's because they want these people to forget. They want to just get reelected through name recognition and the incumbency advantage. And that's what they're trying to do, and we're not going to let that happen.
Well, one point he made earlier, Brian, that I think many people don't quite understand. They hear the words, but they don't quite understand that many in Congress are bought and paid for by the NRA. He stated it directly and forthrightly before. I think a lot of people don't quite understand that. And if there is a tipping point now, it will be from the march to a sustained movement that puts enough pressure on the people in Congress to say, listen, you're either going to cower with the NRA, behind the NRA money and their backing in the elections, or you're going to do the right thing.
But doesn't the NRA's power come more from mobilizing its members versus the campaign contributions?
Well, I know the New York Times had a story on this morning. It certainly comes a lot from mobilizing their members. That also takes money. But the key thing, the ballot box is what counts in this country, and the key votes in Congress of keeping things holed up in committee, even small steps toward doing something sane, something common sense about guns gets bound up. And that's not because of their organizing ability, it's because of their money.
I wonder, David, I've been interested in your story because you were working for the TV station at school, you were the news director of the station, you've been thinking about getting into journalism. Are you still thinking about trying to major in journalism someday, or are you thinking about more of a political path?
Yes. To both.
Still thinking about it.
So honestly, what I'd like to do personally is I'd love to go to like somewhere like Harvard for poli-sci or go to Northwestern for journalism. But honestly, like even the day after the shooting, I got rejected from one of my safety schools, Cal State Long Beach.
It happens to all of us.
Yeah, it does. It really does. But I mean, honestly, I just want to continue on. I want to continue learning. I might have to take a gap year to work during midterms to help on these campaigns. But I want to continue to change the world, and the only way I'm going to be able to do that, and the only way the American public is going to be able to do that, is through education.
Anything you want to know from Dan Rather?
Got any advice?
Writing is the bedrock of the craft. If you want to do anything in journalism, learn to write, dedicate yourself to a lifetime of improving your writing. I can't guarantee you'll be famous or make a lot of money, but you can have a very satisfying career if you concentrate on writing.
Absolutely.
And that actually would apply to activism as well, right? To giving a political speech. Working on honing the writing. Yeah, that's interesting.
Well, exactly.
Yeah.
That the best politicians are those who write their own speeches.
Huh.
John Kennedy, Barack Obama, Ronald Reagan to a degree.
Right, right. Well, to the both of you, thank you for both being here. Great to see you.